Is it much light now?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, great. Well, it's a pleasure, as I said, to be able to give a presentation. And today I would like to talk about LEEM, low energy electron microscopy, and basically also its transmission counterpart that we called EVTEM, which is basically TEM at very low electron volt energies. And I will introduce them as probes to study van der Waals materials. And to be really honest, today it's mostly graphene. But graphene is then, let's say, a fruit fly for van der Waals materials. Now, I realize the audience today is mostly familiar with SEM and TEM and maybe STEM, and not so much with LEEM. So let me start with giving you just a historical overview of what how LEEM developed. In fact, LEEM was developed on paper first in 1962 by somebody called Ernst Bauer, who was a professor in Clausthal-Zellerfeld and who's now a professor in Arizona. He's still active, he's like 88 years old or so. After inventing this on paper, it took 23 years before it worked, which is quite dramatic if you think of all the people that worked on it, but he was very perseverant. And finally, with his PhD student Teleeps, they got LEEM to actually work. Now, this was of course a great success, but then it was a great tragedy because Teleeps had a car crash just after succeeding and he actually died. So this again set back LEEM, but there was an acceleration finally with new PhD student and Ernst Bauer started a company called ElmiTech. And basically in parallel with that, Ruud Tromp, who did his PhD at Amolf, as a Dutch person working at IBM, designed another type of LEEM, which is the IBM LEEM. And basically this is the type that we have in Leiden. And the IBM LEEM is commercialized by Spex. Spex is a company in Germany. And Ruud is actually involved in the research program that I will be talking about. Now, LEEM is, compared to most microscopy techniques, very scarce technique. So there's maybe about 50 instruments worldwide. So it's very little compared to, especially SEM, but even compared to TEM. But I hope to show you today that that there's room for more. So let me first introduce to you how LEEM roughly works and what the main difference is with SEM and TEM. So what you have here is a schematic of our LEEM instrument. And it's important to note that we emit electrons from an electron gun. And this gun is at minus 15 kilo electron volt, or kilovolt, I should say. And basically, almost the rest of the entire apparatus is at ground. So when you accelerate an electron from the gun, it gets to a kinetic energy of 15 keV. And because in a LEEM, you look in reflection, you want to separate the incoming path and the outgoing path of the electrons. So this is the incoming path. And here in a prism, we use the Lorentz force basically in a magnetic field to bend the electron path towards a sample. Now, just in front of a sample, something interesting happens. There's basically an objective lens, and the objective lens is at ground potential, but the sample is at minus 15 kilovolt, plus a little bit, which is indicated here. Now, that means that the electrons are decelerated just in front of the sample because of the negative potential at the sample. And if it's at minus 15 kV, basically the electron gets decelerated to zero, kind of barely touches the sample, if you will, as a wave, and then returns. Now, if you crank up this extra potential VE, however, you can tune the landing energy of the electron by, let's say, 10 tenths of electron volts. So the transition between the electron touching the sample and just not touching the sample, we call the mirror mode transition. If the landing energy is negative. By our definition, the electron doesn't reach the sample at all. So from there, after interacting with the sample, the electron will be accelerated again towards this objective lens, go in this magnetic field again, turn left, and in principle go to the detector. So schematically, it goes something like this, and then to the detector. Now you see that I skipped a part, and this is the part I will come to talk about in a few slides, where we have an extra path towards an electrostatic mirror. But without that, you already have a LEAM. And the extra path is to get a better resolution by correcting for aberrations of the objective lens. Now, what is special about the LEAM? Well, as I said, it is so that you use electron reflectivity. And the energy that you can tune starts with zero, and zero, as I said, is this mirror mode. It's basically the vacuum energy. And you can crank it up to typically 100 electron volts. It could be more, but it operates roughly between zero and 100 electron volts. And this, of course, explains the name low energy electron microscopy compared to especially TEM. Now then you can do microscopy, but you can also do electron diffraction, basically by changing a lens, turning on a lens over here in the imaging system. And because you do tunable energies, you can also do spectroscopy. So as a function of incoming electron energy, you can look at the contrast in your images. And then, of course, the great thing is you can combine stuff. So you can do spectral microscopy, where at a certain energy, landing energy, you make a microscopy image, or local spectroscopy, where for a very small area, you do spectroscopy, and the same in a way you can do for diffraction. So micro diffraction and dark field imaging. Now, so if we look at the system in practice, it looks like this. So it's of course a big UHV system. And you can tell that it looks a bit more experimental than some of the TEM systems that you may be used to do. And that shows also the stage where LEAM is. It is a commercial system, but it's not yet a turnkey system, I would say, for consumers all over the world. And we are also trying to help a bit to develop that side. But what do you see here? You see a column, which runs all the way down to here. The electron gun is over here. Electrons go from here. The magnetic field, the prism, as we call it, is over here. And the sample sits here. So this camera, for example, looks at the sample. Well, and then this extra path with this mirror is over here. And then finally, the detection. So that is the system. And actually, yeah. You have a question?
Alphonse? We don't see any pointer.
You don't see my pointer. Here. No, do you see my pointer now? Alphonse, do you see my pointer?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Thank you for noticing. Okay, so again, the electrons go take this path, and the mirror would be here, and the detector will be down here. Okay, so what is this mirror doing? Well, basically, it is correcting for the lowest order spherical and chromatic aberrations. Spherical aberrations have to do with how far you are from the optical axis in a lens. And chromatic aberrations, of course, have to do with, well, the wavelength or the kinetic energy, in our case, of the electrons that give you a different focal point. Now, there's different ways to correct for this, and in TEMs, it's done with multipoles. What we do is kind of inspired by the LEAM itself, and that is to use this mirror. So we define basically an electrostatic potential within the vacuum, which lives over here, where these are different electrodes with different potentials. And these define electrostatic potential planes, or bent planes, actually, which make sure that that basically the spherical aberrations are corrected for by shaping this form over here, but also that the chromatic aberrations are corrected for, because in the case of, let's say, a faster electron here, higher kinetic energy electron, it goes deeper into this potential landscape, and therefore you can basically shape the potential landscape such that it has a different reflectance angle. And this idea is, I think, already proposed by Otto Scherzer, but the lady you see in the picture is Gertrud Remfer, who pioneered this idea for LEAM and PEAM systems. Okay, so then we end up with an aberration-corrected LEAM system, which in our case has a resolution of at best 1.5 nanometers, which is to be compared to 4.5 nanometers without the aberration correction. And if you compare it to TEM, of course, it's not great. But if you think about a comparison to the wavelength, we're roughly at about 2.5 times the wavelength of the electrons at this energy of 5 electron volts. So there we do actually pretty okay. The vertical resolution, so the height resolution, is actually a bit better because they're a lot better because there we can use interferences, which basically I will show in the next part of the talk. All right, so this is more or less about the LEAM system. And as I show here, we also have been working on improving detector technology, and we're still trying to do that, or basically using better detectors, I should say. But as I said, after introducing LEAM as a system, I hope the system has now become clear to you, although you may be unfamiliar with it. Let me focus on what you can do with it. And what I would like to show today is also layer material. So I thank the previous speaker for the introduction also, where we would like to study certain properties, and a bit unusual properties, but they help us tremendously in, for example, seeing how many layers we have and what their quality is. So van der Waals or layered systems come in different types. So there's the natural layered systems like graphene, which is one layer of graphite, really. There's hexagonal boronitride, and there's the transition metal dichalcogenides that have just been mentioned. And of course, you can think of combining different layers and make different novel structures. For example, graphene on HBN on some TMD, which is a random choice at the moment. Now, I won't go too much into how they are made, these samples, but originally, of course, this was Begaim and Novoselov with the Scotch tape method. And at the right, you see a quite famous picture that I just used, where you see the dream of combining materials into novel systems, which maybe at one point we're able to design kind of the electronic properties into the system by choosing our ingredients. Now, this is just putting systems on top of each other, but there's actually an additional parameter. And that additional parameter is that you can also twist one material with respect to another. For example, you could have a very famous at the moment, and I will come back to that if time permits, is you can take a layer of graphene and put another layer of graphene on top of it under an angle. And if you do so, and that's indicated in this slide, then you get this twisted bilayer graphene. And depending on the twist angle between the two single layers, you get the so-called Maré pattern visible in the double layers. And actually, this Maré pattern is not just an artifact of your eyes. It's it really has a new periodicity that it brings in. And it's at the basis of something very interesting, and that is that you can even get superconductivity in these structures depending on the twist angle. Now, of course, if you want to do van der Waals physics, then in a sense, a very simple image is this. Suppose we put layers on top of each other, like these Lego layers. Then if there is an interaction of the electron wave functions in the materials, then instead of a set of 2D systems, you will make a new 3D material with a 3D band structure, which will be the idea of a novel designer material. If, however, there's no interactions, basically you can isolate layers, and that can also be interesting. For example, if you want to make a graphene device, typically you will isolate the graphene between boron nitride, because boron nitride is a large bandgap insulator, let's say. In any case, if you put these layers together, what you want to know is information about the band structure before and after, you could say. So the band structure of the single layers and the combined band structure. Now, band structure is, of course, something where you look at the dispersion of the electron states in an energy versus momentum picture. And there are the occupied bands, which are in blue here, that occupy to the Fermi level. And this you will typically measure by photo emission. And if you do it well, you call it ARPES, it's angle resolved photo emission spectroscopy, where you can actually follow also the momentum of the electron states. Now, in LEAM, we can do something else. And there's actually this is what I will discuss in the next part of the talk. And that is that we are looking at unoccupied states. Now, if you allow me to say that the band structure just continues above the Fermi level and even above the vacuum level, we are basically interacting with these states above the vacuum level that are unoccupied. And as we will see later, we can also find dispersion relations there, although these electron states are obviously not stable. They want to go rather to the vacuum, and the electrons want to move out of the state or get inelastically scattered down to the Fermi level in these systems. Now, if you combine ARPES and LEAM, in principle, you can cover the pink and the green area, but not the area between the Fermi level and the vacuum level, which is basically where the work function lives. Okay, there's a lot of introduction. Let me just do one more introduction before I go to some real data. And that is this idea of van der Waals systems. I mean, we tend to think they are nice and large, but we've already seen in the previous talk that this is not always the case. And if you stamp materials, you often just get a mess. So you get a lot of flakes at different positions on a sample, and they're all very small. So if you take an optical image of flakes, in this case of graphene and boron nitride, that are stamped on the substrate. Well, if you see in an optical image, these are just very small things, let's say 10 microns or so. And you can imagine that if you do a regular optical experiment on such a sample, you would measure a lot of substrate. And you would probably intermix graphene and boron nitride properties, because it's hard to really zoom into such a small flake. It's possible, but it's hard. And the advantage of our system is that we can zoom in and out quite a bit. And for example, this is a zoom now inside our system of the graphene and boron nitride. And we can zoom further down to fields of view of about a half a micron. Now, let's finally show you an experiment, because the experiment will tell you a bit more about how this actually works. So what you see here is an image on the left side, and it's taken at a landing energy of 3.6 electron volts. And you see, of course, that there's different contrasts. Now, I've made these circles And what I will do is I will basically measure the intensity of the reflected electrons in these circles for a set of different energies and make curves. And I will do that more or less at the same time as that I show you a movie. And in this movie, I change the landing energy from negative, where all the electrons are reflected because they don't even reach the sample, to positive through this 3.6 electron volt up to about 7-8 electron volt. And I will just show the movie and of course hope that it is visible to all of you. No, does it work? Can somebody tell me if it works?
It works.
Okay, good. Okay, well, that's great. So then you see that the contrast is changing per area, but also that even the contrast can invert. So different areas have different minima and maxima in contrast. And if you look to the right, this is now the same thing in the graph, as I told you, and then the movie is nicely running continuously. And what you, these curves are, by the way, offset, just for clarity, but what you see is that the blue circle here gives an area with one minimum in the intensity at around 2 electron volt. The next one has 2 minima and a maxima in between. And then there's 3 minima, and there's actually 4. And if you want, there's 5 over here. Now, what it turns out to be is that these curves, these spectra, if you will, are characteristic for the number of graphene layers that are on top of this substrate. So basically here, there's one layer of graphene, here there's 2, here there's 3, 4, et cetera. With a little caveat that I will come back to in the next slide. And how should you visualize these states? Well, for that, let me first introduce something that you need. This is graphene on silicon carbide. And on silicon carbide, the first layer that is made is a graphene-like layer, but it's not conductive because it's chemically still bound to the silicon below. Over here. But what it does do is it allows for an interlayer state with the first real layer of graphene, which I indicated over here. This is not really the wave function, but it's basically a resonant state, if you will. So when an electron comes in with the right energy, basically it gets transmitted through this state. And when it doesn't come in resonantly, it gets reflected. So this explains why in the graph, you get a minimum in the reflection, because it's really in this picture, a maximum in the transmission. And of course, when transmitted, this electron goes into the substrate and we don't see it in LEEM anymore. Now, if we add another layer of graphene, you get 2 of such states. And well, these states are not, they see each other. So what they will do is they will couple and they will form a symmetric and an anti-symmetric state or something like a lower energy and somewhat higher energy state. And basically this will make the minimum split up into 2. And that will continue for 3 and 4, et cetera, layers until you get graphite, where this actually becomes a continuum, like a band. Now, so the physics is tight binding like, so you can even compare it to 2 atoms joining in bonding and anti-bonding states. The thing is, of course, that our bonding state here is not really bonding. It's still above the vacuum energy and therefore by itself unstable. Okay, so that is the first step. So now we're able to locally, on the scale of really a few nanometers, say how many layers of graphene we have in a sample. Now let's see if we can extend this to measure also band-like structures in the sense that can we now also introduce momentum in the plane? What we've done up to now is that we have basically come with the electrons perpendicular to the sample. I can show you roughly, not exactly perpendicular, but here in this image. But the nice thing in the LEAM is that we can control the direction of the beam. So what we can now do is we can come with an angle, which means with a parallel momentum to the plane of the graphene, and have interaction of this electron with the sample, and see if the reflection minimum takes place at a certain energy. And basically then you can relate the reflection minimum to the in-plane K vector and see if it changes if you change the in-plane K vector. Now, and this is basically what I meant with this pink area that I showed you before. And I would like to mention these two guys, Jaap Kautz and Johannes Joost, who made this actually work. So let me introduce how that looks to you. So let me first show you another one of these reflectance curves. So this is what such a reflection curve, and you see that there's two minima here. So there's two layers of graphene on top of a buffer layer, or, and that I should introduce now, this is like, this can also be three layers of graphene stamped on some other substrate. In any case, two minima. And this graph is now converted to a color scale on the left. And the minima are blue, as you can see here. So that means there's a state. And for example, this area is red, there's no state. And here's maybe a state again. Now what we'll do is we change the in-plane momentum in two different directions actually in K space. And what you see then is this. So what you very nicely see is that these states do have a dispersion. You could even define something like an effective mass, if you will, because it looks pretty parabolic. And these effective masses are also a bit different for the two states that we have here, the bonding and this anti-bonding state of electrons. And you see also above here, this area is a big band gap. Now, this you can do for actually different areas. So this is now two layers with one of these states, three where they split, four where you get three states. And if you take, let's say, infinite number of layers, you get graphite, and then you see nicely that there's our continuum, and that this is, for LEAM, one big minimum in reflectance. And this you can basically, it's basically tight binding. You can take two atoms or states, and three, and four, and five, and go to a large number, and then you get this graphite-like characteristics. Now, what is special is that this can now be done for areas of the order of 10 by 10 nanometer squared. So you can really follow this very closely and look at differences very closely between different areas. And just to demonstrate to you that this is not only working for graphene or graphite, here's a material called HBN, which is this insulator with a lattice structure that is very much like graphene. But instead of carbon atoms, it has boron and nitrogen atoms. Now, same trick. And what you see here is now the characteristic for this boron nitride bulk. And you see again a similar band here. Again, this is bulk. So this is like the graphite. And you see a band gap, you see another state, and you see another band gap. But you can also see it looks different than graphite. So it looks a bit like an alien with goggles to us with a smile, but it's of course up to your imagination. But it is different, and it's characteristic for the material. We have a collaboration with Eugene Krasovsky in the Basque country in Spain, and he made a calculation of what you would expect for the measurement in this technique, and this is the calculation, and you see it corresponds rather well. But I think the correspondence is even nicer if we now compare the band structure that he calculated. It's kind of the projected band structure. So the lines that you see are so are separating areas with a density of states and without a density of states. So over here, you see there is a density of states. Here there is not, so there's a band gap. Also here is a band gap. And now we can compare our measurement to this calculation to get the intuition right. Is this really true, what I've been telling you? And you see that that it works rather nicely. So where you expect states, you see a low reflectance. Where you expect a gap, you see high reflectance red areas, even in little pockets like you have here and here. So I'm just, well, for some of you, this is standard, but hang on. I have to be more patient. Yeah. So this is now in reciprocal space, the same measurement, but this is basically how it looks in the Brillouin zone. So in the center, you have the gamma point, you have the K and the M points, and the measurement has gone along these directions. And the Z-axis is, of course, the energy that we have used. Okay. Now, what is also possible in our system is that you turn off the electron gun and you just turn on a lamp. Ideally a lamp with high enough energy like UV light, so that with the photoelectric effect, you can free electrons from your sample and image these. That's possible. The imaging system doesn't care where the electrons come from. So you can do this. This is actually called beam photo. Photo emission electron microscopy. But again, you can also do this spectroscopically. So in fact, for time reasons, I won't go in all details, but because of this prism, because of the angle the electrons made, we can separate different energies of the electrons coming from the sample. And with that, we can also do spectroscopy on these electrons. We can actually do ARPES, angle resolved photo emission spectroscopy. And that means that in our instrument, we can now combine these two techniques. So at the left, you see for graphite at the top, you see more or less the measurement that I showed you before, which is a Lee measurement. And at the bottom, you see the photo emission bands that we have measured also in the same system. And at the right, you see the same for boron nitride. Occupied states are here. This area, we don't have measurements because this is between the Fermi level and the vacuum level. And this is where we use our Lehm reflectivity. And the technique that I've introduced to you, we have actually coined ARES, just to make it a bit connected to ARPES, which is angle resolved reflected electron spectroscopy. So you see very nicely now that you can get a good idea of the band structure of these materials. But of course, there's this missing part, which is at the crucial energy scale, I must admit, which is here. But what is nice for boron nitride, for example, is that this is actually the valence band, and this is actually the conductance band, and the gap is over here. So there, for boron nitride, there is no state here. So we didn't miss much. For graphite, we do miss states. Okay. Why is this also relevant? Well, for a funny reason that has to do with photo emission, these graphs show you something that is interesting. Namely, suppose I come with a photon and I kick out an electron from an occupied state over here, and I excite the electron to an occupied state over here, a state that is of course normally empty within this nice band. This state can stay there and then move out of the sample. But the transition from here to here is clearly not forbidden because there is a state. Now, suppose I take another photon and I kick out an electron from the same state, but this photon has a higher energy and it has an energy to go here. Now, over here, there is no state in the graphite to go to. Sorry, this is boronitride, in the boronitride to go to. So here, this transition would be forbidden and there would be no photo emission. So what I wanted to tell you basically is that this Ares basically may help us to understand detailed photo emission results in more detail. So because it matters what the intermediate state is, and in a lot of ARPES modeling, a parabolic intermediate state is assumed, but we can actually measure if there is such a state or not. Okay. Now, I want to shift gears a bit, because now I've explained to you how this spectroscopy works and how we can measure band-like dispersions with LEAM in reflection. But I have also claimed that if we see a minimum in the reflectance at a certain energy, that this is because of a high transmission. And this, of course, immediately makes you pose the question, why don't we measure in transmission? And this is exactly what I want to talk about next. And that is, suppose we take away the substrate and we look in transmission, will we see a maximum in the transmission as a function of energy? Now, this idea is in a way simple and simply implemented. Of course, it's never as simple as it is on the PowerPoint physics, but in principle, we turn off the gun for reflectance and we make sure that we add a gun behind the sample so that just like in this photo emission type experiment, we have the electrons now coming through the sample and then they are imaged in the same way. Now, for that, we had to design an electron gun that basically emits and focuses electrons where behind the sample. And this was done by Daniel Gehlen, a PhD student who is now a doctor, so he finished. And the tricky thing is you have to do that within a centimeter. So there was some designing and some machine workshop work, and not as trivial as it may look now. But he succeeded. And at the moment, Peter Noy, who is in the audience, is actually working on the same system. Now, why would it work? Because what we are now trying to do, of course, is to do TEM at very low energies, and nobody does TEM at very low energies. I mean, the people that do TEM here are all working even higher than the scale over here at hundreds of kilo electron volts. And why is that? Well, of course, that is because your penetration depth of electrons is much higher when they have more energy, and the scattering interaction time is also very short. But if you go down in energy from these TEM energies, this penetration depth will go lower and lower and lower. And then, and that's interesting, there will be a minimum. And when you go lower in energy again, it will go up. And basically this is because there's less and less quantum interactions. So if the electron, for example, has an energy below the electron, the energy of, let's say, a surface plasmon, it will not be able to excite the surface plasmon and therefore also will not be scattered. So that is why this is happening over here. Now, in this curve, which is actually rather old, as you can see, is the so-called universal curve, because the idea is that this curve is more or less the same for all materials. The minimum around here is typically where LEAM is used, because then you can be really surface sensitive. But what I've shown you is mostly around here so far, even. Okay, this I've told, but basically now we try to do TEM at these energies in which the mean free path goes up again. So let's see if we can make that work. And let's look at a picture of Daniel and Peter. Daniel's at the top. And what we have done is we have made TEM grids, basically with holes, and on top we have Well, sometimes graphene and sometimes graphene with gold nanoparticles, but I will focus on the graphene now first. So at the right, you see already a transmission image. Some holes are empty, so they're, this is just a straight transmission from the gun. But other holes, like here, you see a structure. So let's zoom into that structure. And then at the left, you see an image at around 8 electron volts, electron energy, and you see that indeed you can make an image. So that's the first thing already, which was very important for us, that it actually can work. But you also see there's different contrast again between different areas, which are already labeled. This is 1 layer, 2 layers, and 3 layers of graphene. And because now we can turn off the electron gun for transmission and turn on the electron gun for reflection, we can also make a reflection image at the same place. And you see the same, well, egg-like shape over here, which is now in... which is our, sorry, this is my Siri. I'll try to get rid of it. You see that it's in reflectance. So in TEM, you saw the hole very clearly and you see no transmission outside of the hole, but of course you do see reflectance outside of the hole. So this is LEEM. And you see that the contrast here, for example, the thickest layer has here a higher reflectivity, which is in line with what I told you before with these resonances. Okay, so let's have a look again in transmission. So you can compare these three areas, and these are now pictures taken at 5 and 11 electron volts. And you see that, for example, the area in the center, C, where there's triple layer, here has hardly any contrast at 5 electron volt with double layer, but here the contrast at 11 volt is much higher. Right? So apparently here also you do get spectra. So let's make the spectra, measure the spectra for such a sample. And here I combine reflection in blue and transmission in green. And what you see is that, as promised in a way, where there is a dip in the reflection, so there's a state in the reflection, there is a maximum in the transmission. So it means our picture seems to work. And in fact, you see that the next state that I pointed out in the very beginning has also a peak in the transmission connected to it. So this is indeed a next order interlayer state. Now this was for double layer graphene. For triple layer graphene, you see you get 2 minima in reflectance and more or less 2 maxima in transmission, or a maximum in a shoulder, I should really say. And that is again, what we had expected to see. Now just two things to add to this. Of course, you see that the reflection and the transmission don't add up to 1, which they should if everything were elastic. So this means that we have a lot of inelastic processes, and in fact, we have more and more as we go up in energy. So this will also give us a way to distill out inelastic and elastic scattering length. The other remark I would like to make is there are points, for example, here at 6 electron volts, where the transmission and the reflectance are the same. So you could kind of see this now as an electron beam splitter there, which has as much transmission as reflection. It's not 50-50, but it's equal. So if you ever dream of further interference experiments with electrons, then maybe a triple layer of graphene could work there as a beam splitter. Okay, I guess I'm close to running out of time, but I have like 4 or 5 slides. How am I doing, Sonia?
Go ahead.
Okay. I will keep this brief and won't go into the analysis, but this is more or less what I conveyed just now. So what we are measuring really is all the perpendicular transmission and reflectance. So we use an aperture here to select the electrons. And that means that in the curves that I just showed, the spectra that I just showed, electrons that are scattered over an angle or electrons that are absorbed are outside of our measurement. So if we see these as inelastic processes, they help us to actually deduce inelastic path lengths as a function of energy. So that's something we analyzed, and it's actually in the paper that I cite here. But I chose not to discuss it in detail here because the last few slides, I just want to connect to the hot topic of this moment, at least a hot topic of this moment, which is twisted bilayer graphene. And I kind of introduced it already in the beginning. But basically, if you put two layers of graphene on top of each other, depending on the twist angle between them, you get this moiré pattern. And the larger the angle, the smaller the moiré pattern. And now what is exciting about this system is that at an angle around 1.05 degrees, this system turns out to be a superconductor. And this is why this is called the magic angle, or one of the magic angles to be more precise. At the left now, you see how the moiré structure actually depends on the twist angle, if your computer follows my movie. And let's have a look at this discovery, which was done by Pablo Jarillo, who was a PhD student in Delft. So he has a good background. And he showed here for two samples, one with a twist angle of 1.16 and one with a twist angle of 1.05, that in this system, you can find superconductivity with a TC depending on the angle. For 1.05, it's 1.5 Kelvin or so. For 1.16, it's already a lot lower. So it depends quite critically on this twist angle. And in fact, he also sees MOT insulating phases, which I won't go into, but there's a lot of the physics that is kind of similar to what you see in high TC superconductors. And what is part of the theory of these systems is actually that there's a band that goes flat when you start to twist layers of graphene with respect to each other, exactly at this magic angle, the bands at the Fermi level go flat. And this is basically resulting in MOT-like physics, and MOT-like physics with doping can give rise to superconductivity. Now, Tobias, who is also in the audience, has been working on this system recently with the group of Milan Allen and Jack Benschop, more exactly, to find out if we can see from the moiré structure and from diffraction which areas of a sample of twisted bilayer graphene are actually close to the magic angle. Well, immediately you can see that there's domains. It's not completely one thing, but it turns out that this area is very close to the magic angle. And then photo emission experiments that were not done in Leiden, but in Paris by Felix Baumberger actually show that here indeed you can find a flat band. Now, what we can do now, and this is really something that Tobias pioneered over the last year, is that we can nowadays even measure and image the moiré structure, even up to 1 degree of the twist angle. And for that, let me show you this sample, which is a sample made by Xing Chen, who is a PhD student with Michiel de Dood and me. And so this is bilayer graphene, and you see very nicely that we can now image the moiré pattern. And what you see is now that the moiré pattern is not the same everywhere. So there's strain, there's variations locally in the twist angle, and this will probably locally also influence the properties. And this is actually a picture in green of bilayer on bilayer. So this is four layers. at 1 degree. And I think this is really amazing because it gives you a lot of new possibilities, not only of characterizing, but also of understanding the physics. All right, so let me go to the summary. So I hope to have convinced you that LEEM is a promising sibling of TEM and SEM, and that there are many developments going on in our group and other groups that can be applied to also systems that are really interesting at the moment. Then I've introduced how we measure unoccupied bands and how we can add a gun to our LEEM system to make it a TEM, but at the energies that you are usually not thinking about. Now, let me just end with some current and recent developments. So one is that we are trying to do our analysis better, so our image analysis by different methods. Some are very standard in TEM, but not for us. And we're working on low temperature LEEM. And as of January 1st, we have started a European program, which is actually the parallel program to Albert Polman's program, in which we are going to work on something that we called optical near field electron microscopy. I have not talked about it yet, but we're starting it up, and we actually have a vacancy for a postdoc. So if you know somebody or you are yourself interested, please let me know. And then I would like to thank all of you and thank especially also the people that worked on all this research, Tobias, Jaap, Daniel, Ruud, Zing, I think, and Peter are the main people here. All right, thank you very much.